Good morning, everybody. My name is Moshe. I'm going to present a co-work with Nadav, Amit, and Tsafrir. The work is going to be about IOMMU. So what is IOMMU? IOMMU is IO memory management unit. The role that the IOMMU plays for IO devices is similar to the role that the MMU that we know plays for processes. They both translate virtual addresses to physical addresses, but the IOMMU does it for IO devices and the MMU does it for processes. The device accesses the memory via a DMA. All the device memory access in this presentation is going to be DMA. Direct memory access is very dangerous. The device can access memory location it is not supposed to. For example, in virtualization, one guest can access the host memory or other guest memories. And without virtualization, a device with a buggy driver or a malicious device can access the memory of the other device or, worse than that, the memory of the operating system. So once the IOMMU is enabled, it doesn't allow such wrong accesses. Devices can only access the memory that belong to them. On the right, the IOMMU provide inter-OS protection, and to the left, the IOMMU provide intra-OS protection. Our work is focused in intra-OS protection, which is without virtualization. It's only bare metal. So how intra-operating intra-OS protection works? Before the DMA, the IOMMU driver allocates a virtual address. And then it updates the page table of the domain of this device to have the mapping from this virtual address to a physical address. Now the device can access the memory via virtual address. And when the DMA is done, we remove the translation from the page table, free the IOVA, and invalidate the IOTLB entry. Now the device can't access this virtual address anymore, and this is how the operating system makes sure that the device accesses only the memory location it is supposed to access. What we saw now called strict mode. We have also the deferred mode. We saw that stage two and three are very costly. And on the deferred mode, on each unmap, instead of freeing the IOVA invalidate the IOTLB, the operating system accumulates the IOVA in a queue. And when the queue is full or a timeout is a queue, the operating system free all the accumulated IOVAs and invalidate the entire IOTLB. The trade-off in this mode is protection. This mode gives us performance, but it's less protected. There is a few milliseconds that the device can access the virtual address that it's not supposed to access anymore. So what's the performance cost? The x-axis shows how many cycles it takes to process each packet. The y-axis shows the throughput of the system. For starter, before measuring, we can compute the throughput analytically with the displayed formula. For example, when the process of each packet takes 4K cycles, The throughput is about 9 gigabit per second. The formula is represented by the red line, which we use as a model. We run NetPerf TCP stream on Linux servers with the IOMMU disabled, and the result was 20 gigabit per second. This point is our baseline. We are going to compare our next result with this point. We repeated the benchmark for the measurement, which will be displayed in the next slides. Now we run the same benchmark again, but with the IOMMU enabled on strict mode. And we got less than 2.5 gigabit per second. We can see that the strict protection is very, the cost of the strict protection is very heavy. Now we run the same benchmark with the deferred mode. As expected, the performance is improved because of the batching that we talked earlier. But again, we need to understand that here we have less protection than the strict mode. So why is IOMMU so costly? A common wisdom is that hardware is to blame. But we saw a correlation on the previous graph between the number of cycles it takes to process a packet and the throughput. And our claim is that software is guiltier. We claim that operating system drives the IOMMU with suboptimal software. This software can be much improved, and it's not going to be only in Linux. Actually, all the operating system we examined, there could be an improvement of performance by changing only the code, only the software. Now let's look at the overhead breakdown. Again, we run the same benchmark. The x-axis shows the protection mode, strict or deferred. The y-axis shows the average number of cycles for processing one packet in the benchmark we run. This breakdown contains few parts. The IOVA part is in red. It's all the allocation and the deallocation of the IOVA. The blue is the IOTLB invalidation. The green is the updating of the page table. And all the rest, which does not belong to the IOMMU, is black. On the right breakdown, we see that the blue part is disappeared. This is the invalidation part that we wanted to save when I explained about the deferred mode. It's not that the invalidation is not happening at all. It's only happening once in a while. A while is the threshold or the size of the queue that we talked about earlier. In our case, it's 250. So each 250 iteration of the unmap, of IOVA unmap, there is one invalidation, and therefore the average of it is about 20 or 30. And this is the little line that we saw, that we see between the IOVA and the green part. Another thing that we can see is that the red part is less in the deferred than in the strict mode. The strange thing is both strict and deferred, the IOVA part is too long. The IOVA allocation is actually allocation a number that nobody else uses. And we think that almost 10,000 cycles for allocating a number, it's too much. So we address this problem. Let's take an overview of the allocation algorithm. This is going to be our example of the Linux operating system, the Linux improvement. The IOVA Linux allocator contains a balanced tree of allocated virtual ranges. For simplified explanation, all range size are equal to 1, and the all virtual address space is from 0 to 99. A flattened virtual address space is at the bottom, and the tree is at the top. Actually, the bottom part is not a real data structure. It's only to demonstrate what happened in the virtual space. When the allocator allocates a new range, it scans the tree from cache node that is maintained and iterates from it through the ranges in descending manner until a suitable gap is found. The cache node is maintained such that it is usually pointed to a range that is higher than the next gap that we will be find. In this example, if we allocate an IOVA, 91 will return, and it will be quick. The complexity of this algorithm will be constant. Now let's see a slow allocation. The slow allocation apples on a specific cases which explained in the article. Assume 98 is freed and after a while reallocated. The algorithm will update the cache node to point to that node. Now if we want to allocate another IOVA, we will start at 98, cross almost all the allocated IOVA, and as you can see, this gives us a linear complexity. We call this phenomenon long-lasting ring interference. So what did we do to improve what we saw here? To improve the driver, we still use the old mechanism, but we encapsulate it with a cache. The cache is an array of three lists. Each list contains only ranges of power of 2. To be more general, the list in the I entry of the array contains only ranges with size of 2 to the power of I. For example, the first entry contains a list with ranges of sizes of 1 page only. Why do we keep only such sizes? Because we found that the IOMMU driver round up the size of the required virtual ranges to a power of 2. It does it because the invalidation of such numbers are quicker. And it doesn't waste real memory. Hence, every address size can be contained in the cache. So what do we do? What is our algorithm, actually? On IOVA free, we push the IOVA, instead of freeing or of really freeing the IOVA, we push it to the cache. On IOVA allocation, we look for such IOVA range in the cache, and if we find, we return it. If not, we allocate it with the regular IOVA data structure. So what the results of this mechanism? This is what was before, and this is after. Comparing the IOMMU cost breakdown, we can see that the IOVA reduced the cycles spent handling IOVA deallocation. We reach a constant complexity, so the cycles takes on the district is almost the same as the cycles we spend on defer. So what is the performance improvement? When we put the results of this E of our streak and E of our defer on our graph model, we can see that streak is much bigger than defer because the cycles we spend on IOVA allocation on the strict mode was much higher than on defer. I note in passing that there is a follow-up work which will be presented next month in ASPLOS, where we show that if we redesign the IOMMU hardware to better match its workload, then we can push the performance up to the black point while preserving strict. So this is a spoiler. Here are the results of NetPerf Apache and Memcached running on two servers with Mellanox NIC of 40 gigabit per second. One machine is the server, and the other is the workload generator client. Our baseline is IOMMU enabled with deferred and strict without the improvement. The baseline is normalized for better examining the difference. In all benchmark, the IOVA improved the performance, but as we saw in last few slides, the improvement is higher. Since the IOVA allocation in strict mode takes more cycles, as I explained before. So far, all results are related to Linux, but we found that other operating systems similarly drive the IOMMU with suboptimal software. For instance, FreeBSD that is mentioned in this paper is worse than Linux. We even describe a patch that already managed to push the FreeBSD that improved throughput by 76%. We also found that Solaris and Darwin have similar deficiency, but we found it after we submitted the paper. Conclusions. As I said before, the common wisdom is that hardware is to blame. But we saw now that it's not true. Suboptimal software makes it much slower than it should be, and we can improve that. We found that characteristic of the workload experienced by the IOMMU allow for even our basic and minimal free list optimization to deliver high performance. The free list technique is not something that we invented. It's something that, for example, a real allocator uses for improve the performance of it. By the way, the code that do the cache thing that improve the IOVA allocation is less than 250 line patch. The last thing I want to say is that although our analysis focus on Linux, other operating systems suffer from issues. Thank you very much.
We have time for one or two questions. We're heading into a break right now, but let me ask a question before we do that. What are your thoughts on faster SSD devices being affected by this problem. You focused your evaluation on 40 gigabit per second NICs, but it seems like the same concerns, at least to some extent, would apply to SSDs.
We focused on NIC devices, but another student of my advisor is working on it now, on SSDs and hard disks. So maybe in few months they will get some results and write a paper about it.
Okay. Thank you. Since there are no other questions, we'll break for about 25 minutes and we'll be back at 11 a.m. for the next session.
Thank you.